a body reported to be unlike any other ancient body ever found. Chinese scientists met to discuss the new discovery, but no one wanted to take responsibility for examining the ancient corpse. It was not a good time to fail, especially when Premier Zhou Enlai, one of the most powerful men in China, expected you to succeed.
Premier Zhou told us not to touch ancient treasures unless we were absolutely sure we wouldn't destroy them. He said that if we damaged them, we would be disrespectful to our ancestors and to our country. So we generally left anything found in ancient tombs alone.
China's most eminent pathologists declined to autopsy the body found at Ma Wangdui. Suddenly, an obscure junior scientist named Peng Longsheng put up his hand.
As the saying goes, the newborn calves are not afraid of tigers. I was a fearless young man then, and I decided to conduct the autopsy.
With senior scientists and powerful politicians literally breathing down his neck, Peng Longsheng picked up his scalpel and began to cut.
I wasn't thinking about all the important people in the room. My only thought was that I'd volunteered to do this autopsy, and now I couldn't fail. So I just focused my mind on figuring out how this woman died.
Peng Longsheng did not fail, and his autopsy of the woman found at Ma Wangdui would stun the scientific world. In 1972, Chinese pathologist Peng Longsheng conducted one of history's most astonishing autopsies. On a 2,000-year-old woman, so well preserved, Peng and his colleagues could dissect her like a modern corpse. Her flesh was still soft and elastic. Her skin was the same light yellow color it had been when she was alive. She still had her hair and a wig she'd worn to the grave. When the autopsy team cut open her skull, their amazement deepened. Her brain was only half its normal size, but completely intact. Then, Professor Peng made his first incision into the chest and found all her internal organs still in place and looking nearly good as new. The team removed her stomach, ovaries, and other organs. Incredibly, there was still red blood in her veins. Decades after her modern debut, the mummy from Ma Wangdui still dazzles and puzzles the world's top forensic anthropologists, like John Verano of Tulane University.
What really sets her apart from other mummified bodies, first of all, is the flexibility of her limbs. When I first saw these limbs being moved in this kind of just absolute flexibility, it just kind of made me jump, because you just don't see that in an ancient body. And I thought, don't do that, because you're going to break that arm right off. It's something I'd never seen or thought would be possible in a body of this age.
But even before Peng Longsheng began to cut, archaeologists already knew that the lady from Ma Wangdui was no ordinary mummy. Her name was almost certainly Xin Zhui. She had died about 160 years before the birth of Christ. And she'd always been a star. Archaeologist Charles Higham knows her well.
She was an aristocrat. She was a major member of a ruling family. And she was led a life of considerable ease and luxury.
2,000 years ago, Sin Jue was the wife of a powerful lord named the Marquis of Dai. Her modern home, the Hunan Provincial Museum, displays a life-size reconstruction of her. An elegant, beautiful woman stares at us. But Professor Peng's autopsy suggests a very different look.
The lady's body has shrunk quite a bit. The wrinkles on the skin tell us she was quite fat when she was alive. Many people estimate her body weight was around 70 kilos, quite fat.
The Lady of Dai's love affair with dinner seemed confirmed by the treasures found in her tomb. More than 1,000 artifacts. Two-thirds of them connected with food and drink. 30 sealed bamboo baskets held everything from pears, plums, and soybeans to the bones of pigs, oxen, dogs, pheasants, and some 10 other animals.
We know precisely what she liked to eat. Some of her favorite recipes, after all, were inscribed and placed in her grave. We find the complete skeleton of a swan, for example. We find sparrow's eggs. We find sliced lotus. All these items were clearly readily available for her table.
But the tomb contained much more than enough food for the afterlife. Just because you were dead didn't mean you stopped dining in style. Sin Jue planned to eat her eternal meals off exquisite lacquer dinnerware, the largest set of ancient Chinese lacquer ever found. Draped over her coffin was a beautiful silk banner, showing the dead Sin Jue making the journey to heaven. A soul's pilgrimage toward an eternal banquet.
She was taking with her all her wine containers, for example. She was taking all her lacquer plates. She was taking the food she was accustomed to. She was taking her recipes and representations of servants. Servants made sure that the afterlife, once she reached paradise, was going to see a continuation of the sort of things that she'd been used to. Everything was laid out and neat and tidy and orderly, and life would indeed have been exceedingly pleasant.
For Sin Jue, death was a dinner party that never ended. So was life. For her, on earth as it is in heaven, meant a little thing like death wouldn't spoil the fun. The Lady of Dai and her fellow aristocrats had plenty to celebrate. Life in ancient China hadn't always been so good. For centuries, China was a deadly battleground, as warring kingdoms tried again and again to conquer one another. Even the rich and powerful spent their lives fighting to stay alive. Then, in 221 BC, one of history's most remarkable men, Qin Shi Huangdi, the first emperor, united China's warring kingdoms for the first time. But when the first emperor died in 210 BC, his empire died with him. China plunged into four more bloody years of war, until a rebel peasant leader founded a new dynasty. The Han, an empire contemporary with Imperial Rome and equally splendid. The Han dynasty would rule a unified China for the next 400 years.
The Han dynasty brought to China peace, prosperity, wealth. People were able to, as it were, go back and revert to really enjoying themselves, to party, if you like.
The Lady of Dai would have partied more than most, dazzling her dinner guests with banquets they'd never forget.
There would have been a lot of music, there would have been a lot of incense, there would have been servants coming in and at your beck and call. I think it must have been jolly good fun.
But in the Han dynasty, living the good life was only the beginning.
Your afterlife was going to see a continuation of the convivial, sophisticated, cultured, aristocratic life of the present. And therefore, you had to have the body intact to enjoy it all. What's the point of going to heaven with all your wine and all your food if you haven't got a stomach to accommodate them? Immortality was an obsession.
But not every attempt at immortality succeeded. The most spectacular effort was the most spectacular failure. In 1968, soldiers digging a tunnel near the town of Mancheng suddenly found themselves inside a 2,000-year-old man-made cavern. The magnificent tomb of a wealthy king named Liu Sheng. Liu Sheng spent a fortune preparing for a world-class afterlife, turning his burial chamber into a wine cellar. Building himself a comfortable home inside his tomb, and doing everything he could to ensure his body would never decompose. King Liu Sheng went to the grave inside a spectacular burial suit made of over 2,000 pieces of jade, sewn together with thread made of gold.
It would have taken a single craftsman literally a decade or more to create one of those jade suits. Jade is a pure, marvelous, treasured substance. It had been valued in China for not just for centuries, but for thousands of years. And by stitching together these jade wafers, it was felt that the body could be preserved in perpetuity, conferring immortality upon the person within. When you actually get inside the surviving suits, you find that every single orifice in the body was also plugged with jade.
King Liu Sheng's jade suit must have cost him a fortune. But as he lay dying, thinking of the eternal party he was about to enjoy, he must have felt it was worth the price. But he was wrong. When archaeologists opened his jade suit 2,000 years later, a few bone fragments were all that was left of the hard-partying King Liu Sheng. Even if the Lady of Dai could have afforded a jade suit, she would have been forbidden to wear it. That privilege was reserved for members of the imperial family, like King Liu Sheng, the emperor's ninth-born son. Liu Sheng would have been horrified to learn that the wife of a mere marquis had succeeded where he had failed. in 1972, scientists were wondering the same thing. How did she do it? What they were about to discover would astonish them even more. In 1972, Chinese pathologists autopsied the body of a woman named Sin Shui, one of thousands of death investigations done in China that year. Except that most of those autopsies were conducted within a few days of death. And Sin Shui's body was over 2,000 years old. These rarely seen images allow us to share the autopsy team's astonishment as they discovered Sin Shui's incredible preservation. As they worked, they wondered, how could their ancient ancestors have achieved this mummification miracle? Decades later, scientists around the world are still wondering.
If she'd only been buried a year, I would be amazed at how well preserved she was. But to think that, in fact, she's been buried for 2,000 years and is still in this condition, it's baffling. So the question is, how is this possible?
At first, one incredibly well-preserved 2,000-year-old body seemed to be a quirk of fate. But in 1974, only 300 kilometers north of Sin Shui's tomb at Ma Wang Dui, near the modern city of Jingzhou, Chinese archaeologists found another. A man, and just as well preserved as Sin Shui. He had flexible limbs and soft organs like a fresh corpse. The blood in his veins was type AB. Pathologist Wu Zhongbi led the autopsy team.
It was June and very hot. We put a lot of ice on the floor of the dissection room. I stood on the ice and worked nonstop for 8 hours. We never expected that our ancestors could preserve corpses so well. I felt ashamed because in our own time we couldn't achieve what they'd achieved 2,000 years ago. It was unbelievable.
In the mummy's mouth, doctors found a clay seal revealing his name, Shui. Shui was a magistrate who died in 167 BC, about the same time as Sin Shui. Two of the ancient world's best-preserved bodies had been buried only a few years and 300 kilometers apart. And in China's Yangtze River Valley, a part of the world that seemed to be a mortician's nightmare.
I would say that the climate of the Yangtze River Valley is quite likely one of the worst in the world in which to preserve human remains. Soil in this particular part of the world, of course, is very wet, very high humidity. You have very hot and you also have very cold weather. And so it would be a huge challenge to the Han mortician to be able to preserve a human body forever.
When most people think of mummies, they think of a dry mummy wrapped in linen found in Egypt. That's the old classic one. The Egyptian approach, the internal organs needed to be removed quickly. It was a hot environment. Bodies rapidly decomposed in that type of environment unless they were treated by having the organs removed and then quickly salted and dried. The Chinese method is very different. In terms of the quality of the work, it's quite impressive. In many ways, a step above what the Egyptians achieved.
These bodies aren't mummies. Mummies are dry bodies, easy to preserve. We call our Chinese corpses wet bodies. No one had reported anything like them before we found Xinjiang.
Archaeologist Charles Higham of New Zealand's Otago University believes there's only one way to truly appreciate why Xin Shui looks as good as she does. You have to come here, to the hill of Ma Huang Dui, where she was buried, and see with your own eyes the incredible work of the men who buried her. Xin Shui went to paradise inside one of the largest tombs ever dug, a massive inverted pyramid over 12 meters deep. Digging this super tomb must have taken years and cost a fortune. But Charles Higham believes that if we can go inside the hill of Ma Huang Dui, we can actually feel why Xin Shui's tomb builders buried her so far underground.
This air raid shelter lies directly beneath the tomb of Xin Shui. And the first thing you notice when you come into it is how icy cold it is. It's a sort of natural refrigerator. Indeed, looking around me, I can see that the whole place is stacked with stored bananas. I suppose that they've kept them here to stop them from ripening too quickly. I think this is probably one reason why the Chinese builders of this tomb chose to dig it so deep. They knew that down there at this great depth, that the powers of preservation of this really very, very chilly atmosphere would do their work in perpetuity.
But naturally, thing Xin Shui's embalmers understood. This pattern pressed into her skin reveals another of their powerful defenses against decay. Whoever buried Xin Shui wrapped her body as tightly as they could in an astounding 20 layers of silk. This silk cocoon suffocated bacteria living inside her body. Bacteria which normally begin devouring a human body as soon as it dies. But even this wasn't enough for Xin Shui's master morticians. They placed her wrapped body in no fewer than four coffins, each designed to fit tightly inside one another, and each sealed with a thick coating of raw lacquer. Then they encased these coffins inside a massive burial chamber, over 6 meters long, over 6 meters wide, and nearly 3 meters high. They surrounded the burial chamber with 5 tons of charcoal and a moisture-blocking layer of clay over a meter thick. Finally, they packed the tomb shaft tightly with soil and capped the top with a mound of earth some 15 meters high. Sin Jue's embalmers had vacuum-sealed her for eternity. But was it enough to make her the mummy we marvel at today?
Similar tombs, deep tombs in cool environments in other parts of the world, have not preserved bodies to this degree. They just haven't done it. And so, to me, there has to be some additional element.
Did Sin Jue's embalmers have one more trick up their sleeves? An ancient text may reveal a clue. A text that gives detailed instructions for embalming the dead. It says that after washing a corpse, embalmers kept it cold and wrapped it in layers of clothing. It also says that after they placed the wrapped body in its coffin, the embalmers did one more thing before they closed the lid. They poured in a mysterious liquid. Could that liquid have played a decisive role in preserving bodies? Some think it's possible. Another astonishing find would deepen even further this deepest mystery of the Deva mummy. In the 1970s, Chinese scientists wondered at the lifelike corpses of the Lady Sin Jue and the Magistrate Sui, 2,000-year-old bodies from the Han Dynasty, buried deep in the earth inside air and watertight coffins. It seemed that the key to their preservation had been ancient morticians' sophisticated techniques for protecting them from water and air. But there was another, even more incredible possibility. Archaeologists found Sin Jue and the Magistrate Sui floating in a mysterious reddish fluid. Ancient Chinese texts tell of embalmers pouring a special liquid into coffins just before they sealed them. Were Sin Jue and the Magistrate Sui floating in that liquid? A long-lost elixir for preserving human flesh? Chemical analysis of the coffin fluid only deepened its mystery. It was mildly acidic and contained traces of cinnabar, a mercury ore, and an ancient Chinese medicine for prolonging life. Acid and cinnabar could have helped kill flesh-destroying bacteria. But experts have never stopped debating how the fluid got into the coffins. Some insist it was merely water that leaked into the tombs. Today, one of the world's greatest authorities on the Han Dynasty bodies believes he's found the answer. In 1974, pathologist Wu Zhongbi performed the autopsy of the Magistrate Sui. When archaeologists opened Sui's coffin, it was filled with fluid. But strangely, so was his burial chamber. Even though it was surrounded by clay, excavators found nearly a meter of water inside. They could even measure its depth from the marks it left on his coffin. How could water have penetrated Sui's vacuum-sealed burial chamber and his tightly nested lacquer-sealed coffins? Professor Wu believes they weren't as watertight as they seemed.
No matter how well sealed the paint or the coffin would, it will still have microscopic holes.
According to Professor Wu, eastern China's waterlogged soil slowly rose around Sui's burial chamber. Differences in atmospheric pressure between the water-saturated earth and the dry burial chamber forced microscopic molecules of water vapor through invisible cracks in the chamber's wood. When enough moisture has squeezed through, it formed a water drop inside the burial chamber. Multiply that drop by 2,000 years, and you get a lot of water.
We did an experiment. We made a small coffin, sealed it tight, and placed it in water. After just 4.5 years, the coffin was full of water, so we concluded the coffin liquid comes from outside.
But Xin Zhui also had fluid in her coffin, and there wasn't any in her burial chamber. Since the 1970s, no one's been able to resolve the coffin fluid debate. Now, another discovery has reinvigorated that debate. Lianyungang is a small industrial city on China's seacoast, about halfway between Shanghai and Beijing. Like other Chinese cities, it's modernizing at lightning speed. In July 2002, local museum curator Zhou Jinping got a phone call from a road crew who'd uncovered a strange wooden box.
We knew there were a lot of Han Dynasty tombs around here. I told the road crew to stop digging and told my staff to be at the site first thing in the morning.
The next morning, a museum cameraman recorded these images, never before seen outside China, of the archaeologists at work. By evening, they'd excavated three coffins inside a burial chamber, finding only bones. They decided to transport a fourth coffin to the museum for safekeeping overnight. The next morning, museum workers struggled to pry open its tightly sealed lid until something inside made them stop.
I was about to touch it when my fellow worker shouted, "They are legs, human legs." I was shocked and pulled back my hand. Then I pried the board up and took a closer look. It was a leg. I was scared and jumped back. In my 24 years as an archaeologist, I had never seen a corpse that hadn't decomposed.
The Lianyungang Museum found itself in charge of a 2,000-year-old body of Lin Huiping, the wife of a Han Dynasty official. Decomposing before their eyes in the open air and the 40-degree summer heat.
I ran back to my office and called a group of experts in Beijing, asking them what I should do. But the experts told me they didn't know. I was stunned. If the experts in Beijing didn't know, what was I going to do?
A few anxious phone calls later, Zhou Jinping found his expert in Shanghai, home of some of China's most beautiful buildings. This is not one of them. But Professor Xu Yongqing likes coming here to visit some old friends. Very old friends. Professor Xu is one of China's foremost forensic anthropologists. He's devoted his career to understanding the mysteries of preserving human flesh. This is his masterpiece. Yan Fu Sing, an army officer, martial arts expert, and practicing Buddhist. Yan's been dead about 700 years, but he's in remarkably good shape for his age. That's because Professor Xu has been injecting him with an experimental preservative developed to keep modern Chinese corpses looking good for their funerals. Yan Fuxing is still flexible and moist 3 years after archaeologists opened his tomb and exposed him to the air.
We've done experiments to see if there's any bacteria or mold inside the body. We couldn't find any, so we think this formula is very effective in body preservation.
Xu Yongtian helped Liang Yonggang Museum preserve the body of Lin Huiping. He consulted with the team of scientists who rushed to Liang Yonggang to study the newest miracle mummy. They peered into her with non-invasive body scans, far more sophisticated than anything used on Xin Shui or the magistrate Shui. But in the end, only the knife would reveal her secrets. In this never-before-seen video, filmed exclusively for this program, the team autopsies Lin Huiping and marvels at her ancient embalmer's brilliant achievement.
In our modern forensic work, the bodies we see have badly decayed after only a few hours in the summer, and in winter after a few days. It's inconceivable that this corpse can be in such good condition after more than 2,000 years.
Today, scientists in the city of Nanjing are studying Lin Huiping, and they're interested in more than just her incredibly well-preserved body. Lin Huiping's coffin was also full of fluid. The Nanjing team is testing that fluid to see if it will yield any clues to the elixir mystery. The tests have revealed high levels of magnesium and salt. The salt could have been a preservative or just salty water leaking in from Liang Yonggang's coastal soil. Perhaps further tests will tell. But for now, all anyone can do is choose sides in an ongoing debate.
The coffin liquid isn't a formula for preservation, like the formulas we use today. In ancient times, there was no chemical method for preserving bodies.
I would lean towards the idea that it was an elixir, something that someone very cleverly developed to preserve the body. Now, it's not such a strange idea because humans for thousands of years have been preserving food. To extend that idea logically to the preservation of a body, particularly whether it's a loved one or an elite figure who is of great importance to his or her people, it's not really a stretch for me.
If liquid had seeped into the coffin, it would have brought in bacteria, which would have rotted the corpse. So I think when the corpse was buried, the liquid was already in the coffin.
But even if we don't know why Xin Shui and her fellow mummies are so well preserved, the Lady of Dai has told us more than any other mummy about the life and death of an ancient human being. And it's been a revelation. China's diva mummy has overturned some of our most cherished beliefs about our distant ancestors. To forensic scientists, the Lady of Dai is like a time machine. Most ancient remains are so badly decomposed, they tell us little about the lives and deaths of the people they once were. But China's diva mummy can tell us almost as much as a fresh corpse.
It's really an exceptional kind of snapshot of a person's death, a But not only that moment of time of death, but all of the events leading up to that moment of death.
Studying the body of Sin Shui was like making a house call 2,000 years in the past. And when the doctors examined her, they got a few surprises. While she was hosting all those dinner parties, the Lady of Dai was also hosting some very unwelcome guests. Tapeworms lived happily inside her. So did colonies of whipworms and other parasites. Living with parasites would have been unpleasant, but it wouldn't have been fatal. Something else killed the Lady of Dai. Something that rewrote medical history. Cardiologist Dr. Sung O Chung has studied clues to Sin Shui's cause of death. The lady's funeral banner shows her using a cane to walk to heaven, even though she was only 50 years old when she died. 2,000 years later, X-rays revealed the answer. A fused disc in her lower spine. Her bad back also hints at why she was so overweight. Centuries before television, the Lady of Dai had been one of history's earliest couch potatoes.
She gets weighted on, and she doesn't have to do very much exercise. And that's probably why she gets fat.
Sin Shui's autopsy revealed another crucial clue. Inside her stomach, scientists found over 100 perfectly preserved melon seeds, all of them undigested. Her stomach hadn't had the hour it needed to break them down before she died.
Well, I try to imagine what she was doing an hour before she died. She probably having a very heavy meal. The last part of the meal was the melon. And she liked the marshmallow very much, but she ate in such a hurry that she swallowed all the seeds.
There was one more clue, the most telling clue of all. This cross-section of a coronary artery shows it's almost completely closed by deposits of fat. But this artery doesn't belong to a modern heart patient. It belonged to Sin Shui. Sin Shui's fat-blocked artery astonished cardiologists, who believed that heart disease didn't exist in ancient times. And it allowed them to reconstruct the final moments of her life. Within an hour after she gorged on melon,